Yesterday, USA.
For the good times. For the good times.
This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA.
Quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigg. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
All right. Thank you very much, Fred Foy, and welcome everybody to another edition of The Glowing Dial here on Yesterday USA Radio.
Hi, everybody.
Hello, Steve. Glad to have you with us.
Yes. And, always a pleasure to be here.
Yes. Like I said, we'll be here as long as you folks want us. So
you want us, don't you?
Keep those.
Say yes.
You like me. You really like me. Yeah, just keep those cards and letters coming, folks, and let us know what you'd like to hear as far as requests. If we don't have it, we'll get it for you. If we do have it, we'll play it for you. So it's as simple as that.
I like variety in the shows, you know.
Well, that's what we try to do here on The Glowing Dial. We don't try to stick with any one thing, although we did that Dick Tracy serial, you know, that the cliffhanger thing.
Well, that was crunchy.
For like 12 weeks. Not after it sits in milk for an hour, Steve. But anyway,
that's
rather,
my humor, soggy.
Gets rather, yeah.
Oh, did you know, John?
Whatever you do, don't take off your soggies because your feet stink.
Oh, and incidentally, John, did you know
yes.
that there's a new version of Video Kill the Radio Star out?
A new version?
Yes, by the group called the Presidents of the United States of America. They do a newer
you mean
version
like,
of
Clinton, Ford, Carter.
No,
all
that's
guys?
The name of the group.
Oh, all right. I'm sorry.
And they have a new, a more up-tempo version of Video Kill the Radio Star, a more modern version
up-tempo.
Of it.
Up-tempo? Well,
or a more modern version, rather. It's more rocky than the one we hear.
Yeah, it's more rocky. Yeah, Adrian, you hear that? It's more rocky.
Yo. I'm sorry. Anyway, it's time to get into our program, ladies and gentlemen, as we babble too much during this first segment, we've been told, by ourselves for the most part. We have a couple of great radio programs to bring you today, and also
different.
We have some address information, and there's going to be a change, folks, as far as the address information, so stay tuned for that, please. There is an address change for The Glowing Dial, yes. We'll give that toward the end of the program. Right now, Stephen's going to tell us about our first show.
Well, as all us single people have something of importance, this show goes along with that. In the name of the title is A Date with Judy. And I could use a date with Judy. Sounds like a nice girl's name to me. So anybody named Judy wanted to have a date with me, give me a call.
I don't know any guys named Judy that would want a date with you.
I don't know any guys named Judy.
How about a boy named Sue?
Well, that's Johnny Cash.
All right.
Anyway, A Date with Judy is the show that features one of America's favorite teenagers, Judy Foster.
Played by Janet Waldo,
everybody,
Judy Jetson.
Yes, everybody knows her.
She likes playing Judy's, doesn't she?
Yeah, Judy Jetson, Judy Foster. And this particular episode is dated April 3rd, 1945.
Well, hallelujah. Why don't you reach over to the McGee machine, sir, and we will get this thing rolling.
Yes, I'll do that. You know, this is a refreshing show. I think the audience will really like this one. This is something different. It's not your typical show.
Well, I sure hope so. There's our McGee machine creeping in there. So, ladies and gentlemen, sit back, close your eyes, and remember A Date with Judy, starring guest star Charles Boyer, and we'll be back at you. Stay with us.
A Date with Judy. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a very special treat for you this evening. Here to keep his date with Judy is the celebrated motion picture star, Charles Boyer. And now to keep our date with Judy, that lovable teenage girl who is close to all our hearts. And now let's see what's happening at the Foster house. Judy's parents and her kid brother Randolph are in the living room when Judy bursts excitedly into the house.
Hello, everybody. Mother, may I use some of your perfume?
Well, now.
Father, I've got to borrow your car. Huh? Mother, I can use your perfume, can't I?
Well, for heaven's sakes, Judy, what's going on?
Just everything, that's all. Just everything. Oh, if this were only evening instead of day, I could wear a long, slinky black evening gown if I had one. Right on account of its
now, day. Now, wait a minute, young lady. Calm down. I'd like to know
I wonder
this
if
is.
I ought to wear my false eyelashes.
Huh?
Of course, he's the type who, on account of his knowledge of makeup and everything, would know they were false. But still, eyelashes would be so nice to have on to flutter up and down at him.
Flutter up and down at who?
Why, Charles Boyer, of course.
Ask a silly question, you get a silly answer.
Randolph, find me my French book, please. On account of I thought it'd be nice when I enter languorously into the room if I said something appropriate like, Bonjour, mon bon monsieur. Comme allez-vous and everything.
Appropriate for what?
That sounds like it's appropriate for almost anything.
Or do you think I ought to come in and say, Ah, Monsieur Boyer, vous êtes terrifique, in a kind of a low Lauren Bacall voice?
In a minute, I am going to say something in a kind of a low Humphrey Bogart voice. Something terrifique.
Judy, what is this all about?
Don't you know?
No, we do not know.
Oh, I thought I told you. I'm going to interview Charles Boyer this afternoon for the high school magazine. He's in town to make speeches for the Red Cross.
Oh, is that all?
Oh, I was chosen over every other girl in the school to do the interview. Why, it's a terrific honor.
Well, just how did you get this honor?
Oh, probably by kicking every other girl in the teeth.
Randolph, that isn't true. I merely talk louder than anybody else, that's all.
No hair pulling?
Just Tootsie Whiteman's.
Well, she'll look better without those bangs of hers anyhow.
Oh, Randolph, I didn't actually pull her hair physically, just mentally.
Tell us the truth. Is she totally bald?
Randolph. Oh, isn't it wonderful that I've had 2 semesters of French? What if I'd taken Spanish instead? Oh, I shudder to think of it. But I'm so lucky to have taken French. Otherwise, Mr. Boyer might not be able to understand me when we chatter Francaise at each other.
He's lucky to have a little trouble as it is.
Well, I've got to hurry and get ready. I want to put it right down in my date book. Oh, this is the most exciting thing that ever happened to me. Just imagine me, Judy Foster, going to be face to face with the great Charles Boyer in less than an hour. I can hardly believe it.
In less than an hour? Well, then will you tell me why you have to put it down in your date book?
Oh, Father, don't you understand? When I'm old and gray, I'll always be able to look back in my date book and say, well, I had a date with Charles Boyer.
Yeah, well, that'll be nice.
Well, I think I will wear my eyelashes. They're so luxurious.
If they're as luxurious as the last time you had them on, Mr. Boyer won't be able to see your face through the foliage.
Mr. Boyer?
Yes? Yes, Max?
There's a gentleman here to see you. Says he knows you from Paris.
From Paris? Really? Who is he?
Oh, he just says he knows you. He was the proprietor at the theater, the prompter at the theater where you used to act.
The prompter? Oh, Dubois, Jacques Dubois. Show him in, please, Max.
Right away. This way, sir.
Oh, merci, merci. Monsieur Boyer, Monsieur Boyer.
Oh, Jacques, mon vieux, que c'est bon de vous voir.
Oh, et moi aussi.
Oh, mon ami, mais non, 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 non. We must speak in English. This is America.
Yes, yes, this is America. How on earth did you get here?
Oh, mon vieux, it is a long story. I escaped from France 3 days before the Nazis arrived. Just 3 short days.
Oh, I'm so glad. Jack, you don't know how it does my heart good to look at you. But what are you doing here? I mean, here, in this town.
Oh, I am a war worker. Clack, 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 clack. I push the object like a gun at the factory. I am a riveter.
A riveter?
Oh, oui.
And what has become of the play scripts over which you used to shake your head sadly? No, no, Monsieur Boyer, no. You have forgotten your lines.
Those were beautiful days, were they not?
Beautiful?
I was so cruel when you would make the mistake. Monsieur Boyer, I would say so sharply, you have made the fluff. Alarm, she does not read, as you have said. Not at all, as you have said. And always you were so kind to me, so very, very kind.
Well, you were the best punter in all France.
Oh, Monsieur Boyer.
And now you are the best riveter in all America?
Modestly, I must say so, yes.
You are an angel of a man, Jack. An angel of a man.
You know, when I saw in the newspaper this morning, Monsieur Charles Boyer will be here to speak for the Red Cross, I said to myself, Jacques, you will go to see Mr. Boyer. You will display yourself to him at once and let him hear your beautiful English that you have learned since coming to America. She is beautiful, my English, is she not?
Amazing. Huh? I've heard nothing like it in all America.
Thank you. you are always so good to me, so very kind.
Tell me, how is little Nanette?
Oh, Nanette. Oh, she is wonderful. But she is now a young lady.
Nanette, grown up. Oh, the little baby I bounced up and down on my knee when I came to your house for supper after the play. Remember how you cooked the supper? You were the greatest cook in all France.
Oh, now Nanette has superseded me. She's still a greater cook.
What? Mm. Your baby? She's old enough to cook.
Oh, yes.
But how long ago was it since I came to your house?
Oh, a long time. I remember I would wake the baby, no matter what the hour. She would open her eyes, always laughing. I would say, Uncle Charles is here.
Yes, and she would run to me, and I would pick her up in my arms, and she would laugh, and it was like music. Oh, she was a beautiful child, Jack.
Yes. Even then, you would say, this baby, she has the talent. She will be a great actress someday. And it is so.
She's an actress?
Well, no, but she is a singer. Oh, she has the voice from heaven. Really? Opera, she knows them all. A golden soprano. Someday there will be those who will listen. Someday. But she is still very young. She's just 16.
Hmm. Jacques, if I could do something for her, I mean, perhaps with my little influence...
Oh, no, no, Monsieur Boyer, do not come to ask the favor.
Oh, I know that. But still, send her to me. I would like to see the little Nanette, now a young lady.
Oh, very well, I will. I will send her to see you this afternoon. I will say, Charles Boyer, the great cinema star, would like to see you.
No, no, you say, Uncle Charles, your old friend, would like to see you.
Very well, I will, I will. Oh, but now I must go. This is my lunch hour from the factory. I must be back with my rivet at 1 o'clock.
I cannot thank you enough for coming here. And I must see you tonight.
Yes.
Come to the Civic Auditorium, where I will speak for the Red Cross.
I will be there. Au revoir.
Au revoir, Jacques. Oh, Max.
Yes, sir?
There will be a young lady who will come to see me here this afternoon. Please admit her. I'm most anxious to see her.
Yes, sir.
We'll be there in a minute. Maybe you better not say you're my brother. He might think it's funny, me having my brother with me.
Yeah, I'll just say I'm your baggage man.
Randolph, aren't you excited? Aren't you palpitating?
Nope. Charles Boyer doesn't do a thing to me.
He doesn't? I think he's divine. In the movie Gaslight, when he said to Ingrid Bergman, get me the little picture, I just quivered all over.
That's funny. Not even my hands shook.
Any movie star make you palpitate, Randolph?
Only Margaret O'Brien.
Really?
Yeah, she's my dream woman.
I wonder how Charles Boyer will react to me. I wonder if he'll think I'm attractive. I wonder if I ought to flutter my eyelashes at him.
I wonder if they'll fall off.
Maybe I ought to take them off. Maybe I ought to appear in front of him just as a simple, untarnished country girl. Perhaps he prefers the simple, unsophisticated type. He must get so tired of looking at beautiful, perfectly groomed women of the world like Hedy Lamarr.
Oh, I bet he's sick and tired of looking at Hedy Lamarr. I should have that pleasure.
Oh, here we are, Randolph. This is the place.
Ah, here we are to Casbah. It was so far to the Casbah. But we took a streetcar, and here we are.
Oh, Randolph, I'm nervous enough as it is.
Well, take off your eyelashes and let's go.
Mr. Boyer, the young lady to see you.
Oh, wonderful. Sure in.
Right in here, miss.
Oh, thank you. You, Mr. Boyer?
Yes, yes, it is I.
I mean, c'est vous, Monsieur Boyer.
Oh, it's so good of you to come to see me, mon petit chou.
Who, me?
I'm so happy you are here.
Jeepers, you are?
Come here. Come here when I can look at you more closely.
It's a good thing you took those eyelashes off.
Oh, this is my friend, Randolph.
Oh, how do you do?
Garçon, you know.
Oh, yes, I see.
Glad to meet you.
Won't you sit down, both of you?
Oh, thank you.
So, the little baby.
Are you speaking to me?
You know, you are prettier than ever, my dear.
I am?
Still so graceful in every emotion, and still with the curly blonde hair.
Oh, she touches it up a little.
Randolph, I do not. I merely put a little lemon juice in the water once in a while.
I cannot tell you how happy it makes me to see you.
Really? Oh, thanks. I mean, merci. Je suis charmé de vous voir aussi.
Merci.
I might even add that you're even more handsome dans la flesh than you are sur le screen.
Well, what do you know?
I'm very impressed, you know.
You are?
Oh, yes. What wonderful English you speak.
English?
Yes, you are really an American now, my dear.
Yes, I know. I guess I'll try Spanish next semester.
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed. To be a linguist is necessary in your career.
Well, you're absolutely right. Now, here I am talking to a Frenchman, and sometime I may interview an Italian or a Latin or almost anybody.
Well, language is so important if you hope for the Metropolitan.
The Metropolitan?
I heard you are a wonderful singer.
You did?
With a voice from heaven.
Oh, my goodness. When I sang at the sorority's Jitterbug Jamboree, everybody said I sang beautifully, but I had no idea that people would go around talking about it.
You see, your reputation has preceded you.
Well, that's wonderful.
I've been thinking. Tonight at the auditorium, I will speak for the Red Cross, as you may know.
Yes, I do. I think it's marvelous all you've done for the cause, all the money you've raised and everything.
Oh, well, it's a small thing to do for such an important cause. But I was about to say, there will be entertainment tonight. Music, little acts performed. And what I've been thinking is that I will speak to the man in charge and perhaps he may find a little place for you on the program.
You mean, you want me to sing?
Why not?
Well, personally, I could think of a few good reasons.
Quiet, Randolph. Oh, Mr. Boyer, I just love to sing tonight. I'd be just... Oh, I think it's just simply ecstatic.
So American. It's remarkable.
What would you like me to sing, Mr. Boyer?
Oh, you shall choose yourself. A bit of Lucia de la Mermeur, perhaps?
Perhaps, but probably no.
Lucia de... Well, I don't know.
Mignon, perhaps. Or La Vie de Bohème.
How about accentuate the positive?
I leave the selection to you.
Yes, I think that would be the best idea.
By the way, you have an arrangement, of course.
An arrangement?
Well, that I may give the orchestra.
Oh, yes, I'm sure I could bring an arrangement.
Good.
In fact, you could bring the orchestra.
Yes, would you like me to do that? I'm sure Oogie Pringle and his high school hot licks would be glad to come.
Oogie Pringle? Oogie?
Yes. He's a terribly bon ami of mine.
Oh, I see. Well, suppose we trust the orchestra we have.
All right.
If it can trust Judy, we can trust it.
How shall I introduce you?
Introduce me? Why, as Miss Judy Foster.
Judy? Oh, you use that as your professional name.
Why, yes, I do.
She uses it for a lot of things.
Good. Well, now everything's settled?
Oh, yes.
You're happy?
Delirious. You know, well, this is just about, well, the last thing I expected.
What is?
You asking me all these questions. I came here to interview you, and now here you are practically interviewing me.
Back to A Date with Judy.
I'd like to see Mr. Boyer, please.
Did you have an appointment?
Not exactly an appointment, but I was told I could see him this afternoon.
Oh, I'm sorry. He has a very strenuous schedule. He's made 2 speeches already today. Got 4 more to go.
Oh, I quite understand.
You see, so many girls want to see him, and he's so obliging. Well, he just tries to see everyone. And he would, if I didn't try and protect him from his admirers.
Naturally.
He'd be sore if he knew I was protecting him, but, well, what he doesn't know won't hurt him. Right?
Yes.
He spent 30 minutes with one young lady this morning. She was someone he knew from France. He'd never get a moment to himself if I didn't turn some people away.
I understand perfectly.
Tell you what, you come back tomorrow, maybe. He'll still be in town until noon.
I'll do that. Thank you so much. Goodbye.
Girls, girls, girls. Wish I was a movie star.
Yes, dear. What?
Where's Randolph?
Trailing her all the way home, 50 yards behind. Boy, has that girl got speed.
Oh, it was so wonderful. He called me his petit chou.
Petit chou? What's that?
Cabbage.
Oh, for Pete's sake.
He said the nicest things. Nobody was ever so sweet to me as long as I've lived. Oh, he was just scintillating.
Are you by any strange chance referring to a certain Charles Boyer?
Naturally. He asked me to sing tonight.
Now, wait just a minute, Judy. He asked you to sing?
Yes, Mother, at the Red Cross rally in the auditorium.
He asked you to sing at the auditorium? Randolph, is there any truth in that statement?
Yeah, that's what he said. That's what the man said.
Well, I'll be done.
Yeah, looks like she's going to be his guest star.
I don't get it.
Neither do I, but that's what I think occurred.
Suffice it to say, Charles Boyer thinks I'm very charming.
Suffice it to say.
Father, I'm serious. Mr. Boyer really asked me to sing at the Red Cross rally tonight. Now, I want your honest opinion. What do you think I sing best?
How about Northeast High School, I Love You?
No, Randolph. Somehow I don't think that would be appropriate for the occasion.
You see, Father, Mr. Boyer wanted her to sing opera.
Opera? Now I've heard everything.
I know. I'll sing Bobby Sox Blues.
Well, that'll be a nice change from La Vida Boheme.
Excuse me, everybody. I've got a million things to do.
Dora, do you think Judy is more attractive than we may have noticed?
Well, he must have seen something in her.
Frankly, all I can see is her Bobby Sox drooling.
Melvin, we've just got to go to that Red Cross rally tonight.
Why, Dora, I wouldn't miss it for all the tea in China.
So give as much as you can. Every dollar and every penny you can. The Red Cross depends on you. Millions of hungry, wounded, homeless, sick, and weary men, women, and children depend on you.
Now I am very happy to introduce to you a little French girl I knew. She is neither old nor a veteran of the Metropolitan, but she has a magnificent operatic voice, and she is Parisian. Here she is, Miss Judy Foster.
Merci beaucoup and everything, Monsieur Boyer.
I've got the Bobby Sox blues. I'm just a girl who's got the Bobby Sox blues.
My Bobby Sox blues?
Yeah, Mr. Boyer, what's the matter?
Bobby Sox blues?
Yeah. What opera is that from?
I don't know what I've done, but I know I shouldn't have done it.
She's Parisian. I'm a Fiji Islander.
I don't understand it.
Now take it easy, Mr. Boyer, and I'll get you a chair.
Oh, it was a fine program, Charles.
Oh, Jacques.
I have been watching it from the other side of the stage.
Oh, I'm so glad you're here. We'll get away and have a bite to eat together. Hmm?
Oh, yes, and we will talk, huh?
Yes, we will talk. Your daughter sang very well tonight, I thought, Jacques.
My daughter?
She's a very pretty girl.
My daughter did not sing tonight.
Your daughter did not sing?
No, she has been here with me. Nanette, come here.
Oui, papa.
This is my daughter.
Oh, Jacques, what have I done?
I'm very happy to see you again, Uncle Charles, after so many years.
Oh, Nanette, my dear. Oh, Jacques, I've made the most unforgivable mistake.
Oh, Mr. Boyer, did I sing all right? Was it all right?
Yes, oh, it was lovely, Judy. A little on the unexpected side, but very nice.
Oh, hello, Nanette. How are you?
Hello, Judy.
You two know each other?
Oh, yes. We're in the same class in high school. I think Nanette's wonderful.
Oh, Judy.
Well, you are. She's at the top of the class in studies, Mr. Boyer, and she works afternoons in a bookshop, and at night she studies music. I don't know how she does it all.
Oh, Judy, you make it sound so difficult. And it isn't.
Jacques, to tell you the truth, I thought Judy was your daughter.
You thought she was Nanette?
Yes, she came to see me this morning and, well, you know, you said you were sending Nanette to me and...
I did come this afternoon, but you were resting.
And they did not admit you? Oh, Jacques, what must you think of me?
No, a very natural mistake. It is of no consequence. We enjoyed the program from beginning to end, did we not, Nanette?
We loved it. And Bobby Sox Blues, Judy, it was charming.
Jeepers. Oh, Mr. Boyer, did you mean to give Nanette the chance to sing tonight and by mistake give it to me?
It's all right, Judy. You mustn't worry. It's not your fault.
Oh, but it is. I just feel terrible.
No, you mustn't. Your sweet little song made us all very happy.
Oh, but that was just blues singing. Papa, she deserved the chance and I didn't. And I took it away from her. Oh, I just feel awful.
Now, Judy.
Oh, Mr. Boyer, I'll do anything to make it up to her. Anything. I never felt so terrible about
Judy,
anything.
Judy, I have a good idea. Come to see me tomorrow morning. We'll think up ways and means. We'll put our heads together.
Hmm? Oh, Mr. Boyer, that'll be wonderful.
Judy, it's getting awfully late. You better go to bed now,
dear. Now, wait a minute. Let her stay and study a little longer, daughter. I wanted to keep at that French. Any girl who, with 2 semesters of high school French, can make a Frenchman think she's a Parisian, well, that girl ought to keep right on studying.
Well, Father, I'm not studying.
You aren't?
No. I'm writing an editorial for the high school papers.
You go to bed right away, Judy Foster. It's 11:45.
Well, I want to know how this sounds. I'm going to show it to Mr. Boyer in the morning. Listen to it and let me know.
All right, dear.
Last night at the Red Cross rally at the Civic Auditorium, Judy Foster sang Bobby Sox Blues. But she wasn't the one who should have sung there. The girl whose place she took deserved that honor far more than she. The girl who was meant to be and who should have been in the spotlight last night has worked very hard under great adversity. She has paid her music teachers with the money she earned herself and bought her scores. And her voice is of such beauty that it should be heard throughout the land.
The girl who sang Bobby Sox Blues thought she was singing a lament from the bottom of her heart. But she does not really have any troubles. She doesn't know what trouble and courage mean. Nanette Dubois had trouble, and she has courage. And the Northeast High School Diddy Blue and Gold wishes to go on record as asking Oogie Pringle and his high school hot licks to give up some of its swing music and get some opera into its repertoire so that at the spring dance next week, Nanette Dubois can be the girl chanteuse instead of Judy Foster.
Do you think it's all right, Mr. Boyer?
Judy, it's one of the most beautiful and touching things I've ever read.
Of course, the audience at the spring dance won't be anything like the illustriousness of the audience that was at the auditorium last night.
Judy, but... I'd like you to do something for me.
You would, Mr. Boyer?
Yes. I have here a scholarship to a very good school of music. A scholarship for a certain young lady we know.
For Nanette? How did you get it?
Oh, it was none of my doing. The head of the school had already heard Nanette sing, and it took very little persuasion on my part.
Oh, Mr. Boyer, that's wonderful. Nanette will be thrilled to pieces. I can't wait until you tell her.
Oh, I want you to be the one to tell her.
Me?
Yes. You are such a very nice little girl, Judy. You certainly deserve the pleasure.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Boyer. I'll do it charmingly.
I'm sure you will. Oh, Judy, will you do me a favor, please?
Oh, anything, Mr. Boyer.
Well, would you teach me the words of the Bobby Sox Blues?
We are very grateful to Charles Boyer for being with us this evening. A Date with Judy is written by Elaine Leslie and stars Louise Erickson and Dix Davis. Mr. and Mrs. Foster were played by John Brown and Myra Marsh. Music was composed by Paul Sartell and conducted by Konstantin Bakalinikov. The program was produced and directed by Helen Mack. This is the Armed Forces Radio Service.
Hi, I'm singer Betty Johnson, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts Big John and Steve here on Yesterday USA.
Thank you very much, Betty. Betty Johnson, lovely, lovely lady, singer from the 50s. Lady, we had the chance to interview at the Friends of Old Time Radio Convention just last year, and we're going to be playing that interview in an upcoming episode of The Glowing Dial, so get ready for that. But I hope you enjoyed that episode of Date with Judy. That from 1945. I forget the exact date. Stephen has it in front of him. But that one, with guest star Charles Boyer.
You know, that should have been Cary Grant there instead of Charles Boyer, because then it could be A Date with Judy, Judy, Judy.
Judy, Judy, Judy. I can't believe it. Hildy, don't get technical. Come back to work on the paper. Oh, never mind. Anyway, you have some information to bring to the folks, Steve, do you?
I was just going to talk about my outfit here. I think I'm rather dapper here today. I have a nice bright yellow shirt on and some olive cords. And I have beige.
Olive cords. Could you sing a few of those, please?
I have beige and tan hush puppies. I think I'm a regular Beau Brummel. I'm dressing so nicely here.
I had to hit you in the head with a Beau Brummel stone.
People have been noticing my attire, and they've been complimenting me on it. So.
Well, you have four of them on your car. And hopefully you have a spare in case one gets flat. Like that joke. But anyway, Steve and I performed in a program the other night.
Live,
yes, out in Ann Arbor, Michigan. Introduced some University of Michigan singers doing some old standards, and we used the Glowing Dial as a framework, and that went real nicely. Steve here in this big, bright yellow top. So I was going to make the joke that, Steve's employed, I'm unemployed, he can dress in color, I had to dress in black and white. Anyway.
Strangely enough, I had the University of Michigan colors on, I didn't even know it, blue and gold.
Yeah, well.
I didn't even know that.
If you don't want to be black and blue, it's time to announce our next program.
Well, let's stand by for adventure, because that's what the name of the show is.
Yes, mm-hmm. And we have an episode title, don't we?
Yes, A Fate Worse Than Death.
Huh? And we do not have an air date. I apologize for that. That was not on my...
It's a 15-minute program, that's all I'll tell you.
Uh-huh. Yeah, very good. All
actually,
right.
I probably could have gotten you some stuff, but my house is such a mess, and I've misplaced the reference books.
But good news, folks, John Dunning's new book is due out in May. Yes, that's the latest word. John Rayburn wrote into the OTR Digest, said he had a proof copy in his hand.
Ooh.
And, oh boy, this is getting exciting. But right now, Steve, reach over to the McGee machine.
I'm too excited. I can't.
Do it.
Yes, sir.
There we go. So close your eyes, ladies and gentlemen. Sit back, relax, and remember, stand by for adventure. And we'll be back with that address and to close the show. So stay with us.
Eyes, you can see some things for yourself, but something even a blind man can see better. Murder, for instance. Listen while I tell you about it as we
stand by for adventure.
Gathered about the fire in Dr. Avio's comfortable living room once again are the four friends we've come to know so well. They're settled in their chairs already. Dr. Juan Avio, our host, the famous South American scientist and philosopher, has already led his old companions into a discussion. Captain Quigley, the merchant skipper, Richard Moore, correspondent adventurer, and Major Gordon, retired army officer. Dr. Avio is raising a question as we join them.
It must be an enviable feeling, Major, to have been able to retire from your profession so completely. No worries or hanging responsibilities to go with it.
Well, Doctor, as a matter of fact, it is. I can't say, though, that anybody can completely retire.
Especially a man who's been really active all his life, eh, Major?
That's right, Moore. It takes a lot of doing to get used to devoting your time to hobbies.
Well, gents, I never find that very hard. The minute I get home from a voyage, I just sit down and practice retiring. That's the way to do it. Practice it first.
You do keep up an interest in your former work, though, Major. We all know that.
Yes. I knew a man once who was really completely cut off when he had to retire. Oh?
He had no contact at all with his former life.
Well, that's pretty smart, if you ask me. I'm not...
You'll probably live on an island, completely surrounded by water, Captain. We know your love of the sea.
Why, that's what happened to the man I was just speaking of.
Tell us about him more. We'd like to hear his story.
Well, George Whitby was cut off from the world by both natural surroundings and by his own constitution. When he had first come to Taprus Island, the strain he had been under, the shock of his business failure, and an aging body had all contributed to the blindness which the doctors had pronounced temporary, but which had never been overcome. I chanced to go to his lonely hiding place because Lynn Whitby, his daughter, and an old friend of mine, had asked me to go to visit the old man. She didn't tell me her reason for wanting me there, but from the sound of her letter, I knew she had appealed to me in a sense of extremity. I was surprised, though, to find her there waiting for me. Father sent for me, she said. I came on the boat ahead of you. Warren and my husband will be here tomorrow. Oh, what is it, I asked. Come inside and meet Father first, she answered. I believe you'll know why I asked you to come after you've talked to him. We found Whitby in his room at the rear of the first floor. He looked surprisingly healthy for a man of his age. He wore large dark glasses and sat half facing a great window that looked out over the sea, turned at an angle away from the door. Although he seemed to be dozing when we came in, he surprised me greatly by raising his head, almost as though to concentrate, like a man looking up from work to ponder a thought. It seemed to me that we had made no sound on the grass matted floor, but he knew we were there, even before Lynn spoke to him. Father, said Lynn softly. Yes, Lynn, he answered immediately. Who's that with you? It's Richard Moore, Lynn answered. Well, I was almost too astonished to speak. I had often heard of the wonderful powers of the blind, both in sensing the presence of strangers and in their exaggerated powers of hearing. Footsteps, my boy, footsteps, he answered, when I remarked upon it. There aren't many around this house. Sansom, the servant, and I live here all alone. I always know when it's not Sansom. Here he is all the time. Shortly afterwards, we left the old man. It's partly Sansom and partly Father, Lynn said we were alone. Then she explained her agonized look. They've been together here for years. Ever since Father made such a mess of business and Warren had to take over. The stockholders were after Father, you know, and claimed he had stolen their money. But Sansom wrote me that he was leaving. Father's become very strange somehow, Lynn went on. He claims to be able to read the future. Sansom's very frightened of him. Oh, why frightened, I asked. Has he threatened Sansom with some dark disaster? No, she answered. But he's superstitious. And when Father predicted my husband Warren's murder here in this house, Sansom sent me his notice. Warren pays him, you know. Well, do you believe what he says, I asked? No, she said confidently. But Father's so attached to Sansom that I'm afraid of the consequences if he leaves. Warren's coming all the way here just to prove that Father's wrong. Well, he's a brave man, I said jokingly. Let's hope your father really is wrong. The stage was certainly set for murder the next night after Warren had arrived. It was moonlit and threatening a storm. The three of us, Lynn, Warren, and I, stood near a window, watching silently as a single break in the clouds let a flash of moonlight through. And that instant of moonlight, a tiny streak of silver shot up, shot right at us from the bushes. And then a sickening sound of a knife plunged deep into human flesh. Warren stumped to his knees and then fell full length to the floor, the knife buried to the hilt in his chest. Someone, some deadly accurate hand had thrown it from the darkness outside. I saw the rustle of the bushes as the murderer ran, not surprisingly enough, away into the woods, but towards the farther end of the house. Lynn, shocked with horror, didn't utter a sound. I admired her courage. Help him! Help him quickly, she said at last, panic in her voice. As we laid him on the bed, old man Whitby's voice reached us. Lynn! Lynn, he called. It sounded frightened. Go to him, Lynn said. Go in and see what he wants. Don't tell him, though, and don't tell Samson. When I reached the old man, he was standing breathless by his chair, his head raised already as though trying to sense disturbances above him. More, he said as I came in. Someone just went by this window. A stranger is on this island. Strange footsteps went right past here. It was a moment never to be forgotten, for just then the threatened storm broke with a tropical storm. A crash of thunder. And there before me stood a man, or a wizard. I didn't know which. He knew, even in a moment of great excitement, that it was I who had entered the room, and he knew strange footsteps 100 feet from his house. Thunder crashed again, and as it rumbled away, Whitby spoke. Sansom, he said, bring a gun and come back here to sit. Sansom's answering voice really frightened me. Above the noise of the thunder, I had neither heard him come into the room, nor had I seen him. Yet Whitby, always alert, had heard that light step. He had predicted rightly, too. One and died that night.
That must have had a terrible effect on everybody in the house.
Tell me more. Did they tell the old man what happened?
And did the butler get out right away?
Why, yes. As a matter of fact, the next day the house was in a turmoil. Lynn, ill and distracted, asked me to keep her father away. Sampson, as he had threatened, left immediately, and the new man didn't arrive until late. I couldn't help being astounded at the manner in which Whitby took the news of his son-in-law's death. I knew it. I knew it, he cried out. And then he said a surprising thing. Served him right. You know, he said suddenly, I'll bet I could predict Lynn's death, too, if I wanted to. He was his wife, you remember. But could I, answered? They don't catch that murderer by tonight. He was deadly accurate in his aim. Whitby laughed again. He was, wasn't he, said gleefully. By that time, I was truly afraid of him. Somehow, he seemed diabolic in his lack of sympathy, no matter what his reasons might have been. But there was no stopping. I'll predict Lynn's death tonight anyway, he said. Then he raised his head slightly and went on without stopping. Come in, my dear, and hear about it. Gas from the doorway told me that Lynn had come up from behind while we were talking. She was chalky white. Perhaps if you know what's going to happen, my dear, you can try to protect yourself, Whitby said. I thought Lynn was going to faint. Especially when, just at that moment, a new butler, white-coated as Sampson had been, appeared soundlessly at her side, carrying Whitby's supper. She let out an involuntary little, oh! Put her hands up to protect herself. The butler, not seeming to notice her fright, came on into the room. Whitby laughed. Oh, don't be frightened, my dear, he said. It's just Sampson. He certainly isn't a murderer. He laughed again. But it was then that something strange struck me. Whitby had recognized, even discovered, every footstep in that room, and yet he didn't realize that the strangest sound in the room was that of the steps of the new butler. Father, Lynn said. But the butler was quicker. Not Sampson, sir, he said politely. Both Lynn and I were amazed when Whitby, in surprise, turned his head towards the voice. Who are you? He demanded in a startled voice. I had to move quickly to do it. And even as fast as I was, Whitby's hand shot up to grab my arm as I removed his dark glasses. And there, staring at us, frightened, was a pair of the most piercing, all-seeing eyes I've ever beheld. George Whitby was far from blind. And with a single mistake, he had committed himself as a murderer.
Oh, I'll be everlasting.
Tell us more. How did Whitby know who was coming into the room, sitting as he always did with his back to the door?
Why, that was easy, Doctor. When he raised his head, as I had seen him do, he could see reflections in the glasses he was wearing. But in that light, he could only see figures, not faces. So, the uniform being the same, he mistook the new butler for Sampson. It was no wonder at that rate that he was able to protect Warren's death, since he planned it himself. And it was no wonder he felt safe, for it was a murder no blind man could have perpetrated. It seemed that 2 years before, when he had become temporarily blind, the man had... the plan, as I said, had formed in his mind. And when he regained his sight, he told no one about it. Well, gentlemen, Whitby's name was cleared in the business scandal, but unfortunately, he's found since that prison is even less pleasant a place than a tropical island to be held under guard.
Oh, sort of permanent retirement, eh?
Yeah, he's really out of touch with things now, I guess.
I'll be satisfied to keep up my interest instead of trying to retire after hearing that story. Don't blame me, Doctor.
I still think I may settle on an island, though. Where was that one more?
Well, goodbye, Doctor. Time to say goodnight to our four friends. They're about to take their departure, too. The door closes, and the hour of storytelling is over. But we're all invited to be back next time, when these four meet again, and talk again, and invite you to stand by for adventure.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to The Glowing Dial here in Yesterday, USA. Oh, you like The Glowing Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
Yes, we know what you mean. Thank you very much, Arthur, for that ID spot and for the interview. I think that's one we've already played, right, Steve?
Yes, we played his.
Well, wonderful. Anyway, that's going to just about do it for this edition of The Glowing Dial. As I mentioned earlier in the program, there is an address change coming up, folks. Yes, I'm having to move all my stuff again. for reasons that I won't go into here. But the new address, if you're ready to take this down, of course, let's start with our email address, the same as always, glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at ix.netcom.com. That'll get you email to us, directly to us. The phone number to call if you want to call and leave a message or talk to us in person if we happen to be there. This will be Steve's line.
Mm-hmm.
Is area code 810-774-0112.
I'm on days now, so I will be home in the evenings. You can reach me.
There you go. If he's not watching Babylon 5, he'll answer the phone and talk to you.
Oh, yeah. I will. That I will.
And the new street address, folks, the snail mail address, is as follows. 1401 Key West Drive, Troy, T-R-O-Y, Michigan, 480-83-1055. So keep that in mind.
That
and
sounds familiar, that address.
We're going to talk to our friend Fred Foy and see if we can get him to re-record the snail mail portion of our address clip, and then we can start playing that one again for you. But until that time, we have to do it this way. So that's pretty much all that we have for you. Like I said, stay tuned in upcoming episodes of The Glowing Dial.
I got some more boxes to pack over here.
Yeah, we got some letters we're going to catch up on, too. And also some more celebrity interviews, and Steve said boxes to pack.
Yeah.
Well, that's mainly for me, because I'm moving, you see. Mm. But anyway, all the best to you out there. Thank you for listening once again. Thank you for writing. And this is Big John and Steve saying, keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we will see you on the radio. Bye-bye.